brought to you by Penguin.
Paradise Lost by John Milton, read by Adrian Schiller.
An introduction by John Leonard, read by Marston York.
Both for ease of listening and because it contains details of the plot, we've placed the introduction to this Penguin classic at the end of the audiobook.
Paradise Lost, the verse. The measure is English heroic verse without rhyme, as that of Homer in Greek and of Virgil in Latin, rhyme being no necessary adjunct or true ornament of poem or good verse, in longer works especially, but the invention of a barbarous age to set off wretched matter and lame metre, graced indeed since by the use of some famous modern poets, carried away by custom, but much to their own vexation, hindrance and constraint to express many things otherwise, and for the most part worse than else they would have expressed them. Not without cause, therefore, some both Italian and Spanish poets of prime note have rejected rhyme both in longer and shorter works, as have also long since our best English tragedies, as a thing of itself to all judicious ears trivial and of no true musical delight, which consists only in apt numbers, fit quantity of syllables, and the sense variously drawn out from one verse into another, not in the jingling sound of like endings. A fault avoided by the learned ancients both in poetry and all good oratory. This neglect, then, of rhyme so little is to be taken for a defect, though it may seem so perhaps to vulgar readers, that it rather is to be esteemed an example set, the first in English, of ancient liberty recovered to heroic poem from the troublesome and modern bondage of rhyming. Book One, The Argument. This first book proposes, first in brief, the whole subject, man's disobedience, and the loss thereupon of paradise wherein he was placed, then touches the prime cause of his fall, the serpent, or rather Satan in the serpent, who, revolting from God and drawing to his side many legions of angels, was by the command of God driven out of heaven with all his crew into the great deep. Which action passed over, the poem hastes into the midst of things, presenting Satan with his angels now fallen into hell, described here, not in the centre, for heaven and earth may be supposed as yet not made, certainly not yet accursed, but in a place of utter darkness, fitliest called chaos. Here Satan, with his angels, lying on the burning lake, thunderstruck and astonished, after a certain space, recovers, as from confusion, calls up him who next in order and dignity lay by him. They confer of their miserable fall. Satan awakens all his legions, who lay till then in the same manner confounded. They rise, their numbers, array of battle, their chief leaders named, according to the idols known afterwards in Canaan and the countries adjoining. To these Satan directs his speech, comforts them with hope yet of regaining heaven, but tells them lastly of a new world, a new kind of creature to be created, according to an ancient prophecy or report in heaven, for that angels were long before this visible creation, was the opinion of many ancient fathers. To find out the truth of this prophecy, and what to determine thereon, he refers to a full council, what his associates thence attempt. Pandemonium, the palace of Satan, rises, suddenly built out of the deep. The infernal peers there sit in council. Of man's first disobedience, and the fruit of that forbidden tree, whose mortal taste brought death into the world, and all our woe with loss of Eden, till one greater man restore us, and regain the blissful seat, sing, heavenly muse, that on the secret top of Oreb, or of Sinai didst inspire that shepherd who first taught the chosen seed in the beginning how the heavens and earth rose out of chaos. Or if Sion Hill delight thee more, and Siloa's brook that flowed fast by the oracle of God, I thence invoke thy aid to my adventurous song, that with no middle flight intends to soar above the Aeonian mount, while it pursues things unattempted yet in prose or rhyme. And chiefly thou, O Spirit, that dost prefer before all temples the upright heart and pure, instruct me, for thou knowest thou from the first wast present, and with mighty wings outspread, dove-like sat'st brooding on the vast abyss and madest it pregnant. What in me is dark, illumine. What is low, raise and support, that to the height of this great argument I may assert eternal providence and justify the ways of God to men. Say first, for heaven hides nothing from thy view, nor the deep tract of hell. Say first, what cause moved our grandparents in that happy state, favoured of heaven so highly, to fall off from their Creator and transgress his will for one restraint, lords of the world besides? Who first seduced them to that foul revolt? The infernal serpent, he it was, whose guile, stirred up with envy and revenge, deceived the mother of mankind, what time his pride had cast him out from heaven, with all his host of rebel angels, by whose aid, aspiring to set himself in glory above his peers, he trusted to have equaled the Most High. If he opposed, and with ambitious aim, against the throne and monarchy of God, raised impious war in heaven, and battle-proud with vain attempt. Him, the almighty power, hurled headlong flaming from the ethereal sky, with hideous ruin and combustion down to bottomless perdition, there to dwell in adamantine chains and penal fire, who durst defy the omnipotent to arms. 9 times the space that measures day and night to mortal men, he with his horrid crew lay vanquished, rolling in the fiery gulf, confounded though immortal. But his doom reserved him to more wrath, for now the thought both of lost happiness and lasting pain torments him. Round he throws his baleful eyes that witnessed huge affliction and dismay mixed with obdurate pride and steadfast hate. At once, as far as angels ken, he views the dismal situation waste and wild, a dungeon horrible, on all sides round as one great furnace flamed, yet from those flames no light, but rather darkness visible, served only to discover sights of woe, regions of sorrow, doleful shades, where peace and rest can never dwell, hope never comes that comes to all, but torture without end still urges, and a fiery deluge fed with ever-burning sulphur unconsumed. Such place eternal justice had prepared for those rebellious. Here their prison ordained in utter darkness, and their portion set as far removed from God and light of heaven as from the centre thrice to the utmost pole. Oh, how unlike the place from whence they fell! There the companions of his fall, o'erwhelmed with floods and whirlwinds of tempestuous fire, he soon discerns, and weltering by his side, one next him in power and next in crime, long after known in Palestine and named Beelzebub, to whom the arch-enemy, and thence in heaven called Satan, with bold words, breaking the horrid silence, thus began. If thou beest he, but oh, how fallen, how changed from him who in the happy realms of light, clothed with transcendent brightness, didst outshine myriads though bright. If he, whom mutual league united thoughts and counsels equal hope and hazard in the glorious enterprise, join with me once, now misery hath joined in equal ruin. Into what pit thou seest, from what height...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.